Homage to the Blessed One, the Worthy One, the Supremely Enlightened One. Sadhu, sadhu, sadhu. Homage to our teacher and noble friend, Pinwat Lokuswami Mahansa. Sadhu, sadhu, sadhu. Namo Buddhaya. By special request, today's Dhamma talk will be conducted in English. So the sponsors for today's Dhamma talk are from Kote in Sri Lanka, the Chandrasekara family and their children and grandchildren. So by sponsoring this Dhamma talk, they're all hoping to share this merit with Miss Airangini Chandrasekara, who is celebrating her 85th birthday on the 16th of December. So by the power of this merit, may Miss Airangini Chandrasekara be well and happy, have good health, and be free from suffering. So today, I wanted to discuss a very important topic in the Dhamma, that is the eight worldly conditions. So when we live this life, we face various changing circumstances when we go through life. So what we experience doesn't stay the same. Our experiences are temporary. So when we learn the Buddha's teachings, we learn how to face these circumstances with wisdom, not just reacting according to our emotions, according to the way our mind decides to act habitually. But when we learn the Buddha's teachings, we become able to some degree, master our own minds. So especially, we gain this ability because when we learn the Buddha's teachings, we learn about the true nature of reality, the true nature of our lives and the world that we are living in. So how do we learn this? Because the Buddha, under the Bodhi tree in India, when he attained enlightenment and became the Buddha, he understood the true nature of life and the world. Having understood all of this, having realized this with direct knowledge in his own experience, he then taught what he realized to others. That is the Dhamma. So the Buddha taught the Dhamma out of compassion for people. And if they practice according to his teachings and understand his teachings, realize the teachings, they too can gain the goal that the Buddha gained, the supreme bliss of Nibbana, right? So, it is important, especially when we learn the Dhamma, we shouldn't learn it like an academic subject in school. So we're used to learning in school. We maybe memorize something from a book or something our teacher says, and then we write that down on a piece of paper for an exam. We pass the exam and we maybe forget it within a week even. That's not the kind of learning that we need in the Dhamma. Why? Because in the Dhamma, we need to apply what we learn to our own lives. In that sense, the Buddha's teachings are very different from academic subjects we learn in school. Math, science, English, history, and so on. So we need to learn how to apply the teachings in our lives, and then if we can apply them, we actually get the results from the Buddha's teachings. Otherwise, our knowledge is just a kind of book learning. The Buddha compared a person learning the Dhamma who doesn't practice it to someone, to a cowherd, a person who, like a farmer, who's raising cattle. He's counting the cows of other people, So he doesn't look after his own cows. So by behaving in such a way, he's not able to grow in his business in cattle rearing. So he doesn't get the results of his work. Why? Because he's not actually practicing what he should be. He's looking after other people. So, I wanted to teach a very important discourse of the Buddha today. It's found in the Anguttara Nikaya, the numerical discourse of the Buddha, where the Buddha speaks about the 8 worldly conditions. So the Buddha teaches, monks, these 8 worldly conditions revolve around the world, and the world revolves around these 8 worldly conditions. What 8? Gain and loss. Disrepute and fame. Blame and praise. Pleasure and pain. So these are the 8 circumstances that we meet in life. Now, Buddha says, monks, a unlearned worldling, so a person who doesn't know the Buddhist teachings, a normal person, they meet gain and loss, disrepute and fame, praise and blame, and pleasure and pain. They experience all of these in life. And also, the noble disciple, the Aryasavaka, who knows the Buddha's teachings, who has learned them well, they also experience gain and loss, disrepute and fame, praise and blame, pleasure and pain. They experience all of these. So what is the difference between the noble disciple who has learned the Buddha's teachings and the average person, the average Joe, who hasn't heard the Buddha's teachings at all, when they both experience these 8 worldly conditions? This is a good question, actually. So a person who learns the Buddha's teachings, what kind of result do they gain from that? Right? So the Buddha says, monks, when an unlearned worldling, a person who doesn't know the Buddha's teachings, meets with gain, he does not reflect thus, this gain that I have met is impermanent, suffering, and subject to change. Labo anicco dukkho viparinama dhammo. He doesn't reflect in this way. He does not understand it as it really is. He does not understand gain as it really is. What is gain? Gain is receiving something in one's life. It could be a material possession. It could be maybe a child in the family, the birth of a child. Maybe a promotion at work. We gain various things in life. And when the unlearned worldling meets with loss, we can lose things in our life as well. When they meet with fame, they gain a good reputation in society. And disrepute, they gain a bad reputation in society sometimes. When they're blamed and praised, when they experience pleasure and pain, with all of these circumstances, the unlearned worldling does not reflect in this way that all of these are impermanent, because they're impermanent, they are sources of suffering, actually, and subject to change. Anicchaṁ dukkhaṁ viparinama dhammaṁ. So the unlearned person doesn't understand these conditions as they really are, doesn't understand the reality of all these situations. So what happens? Because they don't understand the reality, gain obsesses their mind. Loss obsesses their mind. Fame and disrepute obsess their mind. Praise and blame obsess their mind, as does pleasure and pain. So in this way, they are attracted to what they perceive as positive things, gain, fame, praise, and pleasure, and they're repelled by negative things, by loss, disrepute, criticism, and pain. So in this way, being involved with attraction and repulsion, they are not freed from suffering. They're not freed from sorrow, lamentation, pain, dejection, and anguish. They're not freed from suffering in samsara, in the cycle of rebirth. So what happens when the unlearned person experiences all of these worldly conditions? They suffer because of them. So they are attached to things they think are positive, and they're repelled by negative things. But the noble disciple of the Buddha, who has learned the Buddha's teachings, when they experience these very same things, gain and loss, fame and disrepute, blame and praise, and pleasure and pain, they reflect in this way. These, this gain, loss, fame, disrepute, praise, blame, pleasure and pain, all of these, they are impermanent. So they are temporary, they don't last forever, right? They are suffering. Because they are impermanent, there is no permanent happiness that we can gain from them. So we gain something in life, we get a present, or we get a new car, we get a promotion, or a new child is born in the family. But all of these things are impermanent. They don't provide us lasting happiness. Same thing with fame, praise, and pleasure. They're all impermanent. Because they're impermanent, they're actually kind of suffering, and they're subject to change. They will change with time, all of these. So in this way, the noble disciple understands all of these as they really are. He understands the reality of these eight worldly conditions. So understanding in this way, this is a kind of wisdom. This is their wisdom of the noble disciple. Gain does not obsess his mind, and loss does not obsess his mind. He's not obsessed by gain, loss, fame, disrepute, praise, blame, pleasure, or pain. So they're not attracted to positive things and repelled by negative things. So by not being attracted and repelled in this way, by discarding attraction and repulsion, by removing craving, the source of suffering, by contemplating on impermanence in this way, they are freed from birth, from old age and death, from sorrow, lamentation, pain, dejection, and anguish. This person is freed from suffering, I say. So this is the difference, the Buddha says, between the unlearned person, the unlearned average Joe in the world, who has never heard the Buddha's teachings, and the disciple of the Buddha, who has learned the teachings well. So the disciple of the Buddha reflects on the Buddha's teachings, reflects on the nature of impermanence when they meet all of these circumstances in life. By understanding these circumstances through impermanence, they are not attracted to them or repelled by them. They don't crave for them. And by removing craving, they are freed from suffering. Then the Buddha taught three verses that sum up this discourse. Gain and loss, disrepute and fame, blame and praise, pleasure and pain, these conditions that people meet are impermanent, transient, and subject to change. A wise and mindful person knows them and sees that they are subject to change. Here, what does the Buddha say? A wise and mindful person. So we need to, when we learn the Dhamma, the Buddha's teachings, we need to memorize them. We need to keep them in mind. Otherwise, you just listen to this discourse, and then when you're actually living your life, if you don't remember this, if you don't remember how to reflect and how to apply the Dhamma to your life, when you experience gain and loss, fame and disrepute, praise and criticism, pleasure and pain, if you don't reflect on impermanence, if you don't remember the Buddha's teachings, then you don't get the result. then you can't free yourself from suffering. So we need to be wise and mindful. So the wise and mindful person knows these conditions and sees that they are subject to change. Desirable conditions don't excite his mind, nor is he repelled by undesirable conditions. He has dispelled attraction and repulsion, they are gone and no longer present. Having known the dustless, sorrowless state without defilements, he understands rightly and has transcended existence. And with that, the Buddha ends the discourse. Now, I would like to explain practically how we meet these conditions in life. So, from the discourse, we can understand the Buddha's teaching, the normal person meets all of these, as well as in a disciple who's realized the Dhamma. So even the Buddha experienced these conditions. So what about us? Of course we will experience them in life, right? There's no way that we can avoid these negative conditions in life. The Buddha once taught, Nachahu nacha bhavissati, nachetarahi vijjati, ekantang nindito poso, ekantang va pasansitu. So there never was, there never will be in the future, and there is not now, at present, a person who is wholly blamed, entirely criticized, or entirely praised. So everyone in the world, the past, future, and present, will experience both of these, praise and blame. So we should be prepared for both of these. So up until now, maybe we've received praise from our parents, from our co-workers at work, but one day, we're going to receive blame. We're going to be criticized. If we haven't already, it will definitely happen. That is the nature of our life. So, now in terms of gain and loss, fame and disrepute and so on. So, I remember while I was in Japan, I studied abroad in Japan for a short period, and I met a dean of the university where I was studying. So he's a dean, he's a successful person in society, right? But in the 2011 Tohoku earthquake, he lost his son in the tsunami. So we visited that place. It's called Natori in Japan, and it's by the seaside. So when the tsunami came, it destroyed all of the houses there. We visited the place by bus, and I could see there's just one layer of bricks. That's where the house was. So when the waves came, it just destroyed everything. I think they were over maybe 7 meters high, the tsunami waves. So he lost his son in the natural disaster. But when his son was born, he was probably very happy, right? A son was born to his family. He is now a father. But what happened later? His son died. Son died before the father. And he experienced suffering because of that. Why? Because he didn't understand the way the Buddha teaches about impermanence. So he was probably elated when his son was born, and he suffered when his son died. He was attracted to gain and repelled by loss. Why? Because he didn't reflect in this way. And in the Buddha's time also, the Sangha was criticized. There was a time when the Buddha and the Sangha of monks, they received the four requisites. They were honored, respected by people. And the people of other religions, they were jealous of this. So they tried to hurt the Sangha of monks. They got a certain woman to go to Jeta's Grove, and after she had gone to Jeta's Grove many times, after people saw her going often to Jeta's Grove, her name was Sundari, so that her name means beautiful, so she was probably a beautiful woman, and after people saw her going there, those followers of other religions, they murdered her and hid her body in Jeta's Grove. So then they were able to later dig up the body, and they accused the Sangha of murdering her. So after people heard this in town, they started criticizing the Sangha. Now, is this criticism true or false? It's false criticism, right? Blameless criticism. The monks didn't do anything wrong. But even still, they were blamed. So this is the nature of our life. Maybe we might do nothing wrong, but we can still be criticized. That is the nature. We should be prepared to face that. Even if we've done nothing wrong, we can be criticized. We can lose our good reputation because of criticism, because of something we didn't do. But all of that is impermanent. Whatever fame we have, we can lose it one day. And whatever criticism we receive, whatever bad reputation we receive, that can also change in the future. As well as pleasure and pain. When I was in Japan on another occasion, I was staying on a beautiful little island in Shikoku Prefecture. It's a tiny kind of rural island. It's very peaceful, quiet, and I was staying kind of in the countryside. I rented a house there. And it was a very nice time that I stayed. I was there about 3 weeks in this like kind of countryside house. And I had a very nice time there. But one day, it was a peaceful few weeks. One day I went down by the sea, though, and I was reflecting that this is impermanent. So whatever happiness I was experiencing, because I was staying in that house, because I was in Japan on this tiny, nice little island, I was there for only a few days. I would have to leave very soon. So eventually I did leave, and I went to the people from whom I was renting the house. They put me up for about another week in this luxury apartment. I didn't even ask for this. They put me up there. I would have rather stayed in the countryside house. But anyway, they gave me this luxury apartment to stay in. A very high-class apartment. One of the upper floors in this large city in Fukuyama. But I also knew there, however nice this might be, this apartment, I'm here for a very short period of time, very few days. This is impermanent. So by reflecting in this way, reflecting on the impermanence of all these conditions, we can learn to face them without being attracted and repelled. We can understand this is the reality of life. We will face all of these. And they're all impermanent. We shouldn't hold on to them. We shouldn't get attached to them. We should try to practice in this way. Now, in the past, there was an arahant named Godatta. Now, arahant Godatta taught this verse. Neheva labhi na labhi ayase na chikittiya na nindayam pasansaya na te dukkhe sukhamicha sabbatta te na lippanti udabinduva pokkare sabbatta sukhita dhira sabbatta aparajita. Now that means, is an arahant speaking this verse, not to gain or loss, not to disrepute, bad reputation, or to fame, not to blame or praise, or to pain and pleasure, the wise person is not attached to anything. Like a water droplet on a lotus leaf, they are happy everywhere and unconquered everywhere. Why? Because they see the impermanence of all these conditions, all these eight worldly conditions. So, by whatever merit we acquired through this Dhamma teaching, by learning the Buddha's teachings today, may we too realize the impermanent nature of all these conditions, so that we, like Arahant Godatta, can be happy no matter what kind of circumstances we face in life. Sound, sound, sound. Now for the sharing of the merit. Today's Dhamma talk was sponsored by the Chandrasekhara family and their children and grandchildren in Kote, Sri Lanka. So by sponsoring this Dhamma talk, whatever merit they acquired by sponsoring this Dhamma talk, they hope to share that with Miss Airangani Chandrasekhara, who is celebrating her 85th birthday on the 16th of December. So, by the power of this merit, may Miss Airangani Chandrasekhara be well and happy, have a long life, and be free from suffering. Let us also share whatever merit we acquire today through this Dhamma talk with all of the devas of the world. May they rejoice in this merit, be well and happy, and realize the Four Noble Truths in this Gautama Buddha's dispensation. May we also share any merit we acquired today with our teacher, Pinwat Lokaswami Nansi. May Lokaswami Nansi be well and happy, have long life, good health, and realize the Four Noble Truths in this Gautama Buddha's dispensation. Also, the sponsors of today's Dhamma talk would like to share the merit acquired today with their departed relatives and loved ones. So, Walter Pereira Chandrasekhara, Arthur Pereira Chandrasekhara, and Imalin Chandrasekhara, as well as James Pereira Chandrasekhara, Justin Pereira Chandrasekhara, William Veerasinghe and Somavati Veerasinghe, Nimal Veerasinghe and Chandra Veerasinghe, Siri Soma and Hemapali Pereira, as well as Dharmasena, Kusum, Arambavatta, George and Irene Vikramasinghe, Jayasekara, as well as Mihinda Dasa, Gunawardana. So all of their relatives, their departed relatives, they would like to share this merit with them. So may all of their departed relatives be well and happy in their next life, and may they, by rejoicing in this merit, be free from the suffering of samsara. Let us also share the merit we acquired today with Somavati Gunawardana, Miss Somavati Gunawardana, who has recently undergone surgery. May she be well and happy and recover quickly from her surgery, and may she too realize the Four Noble Truths in this Gautama Buddha's dispensation. In addition, let's share today's merit with today's sponsors, their parents, Indrani Dasanayaka, Bhadra and Jatila Mahawatta, Saranagupta Veerasinghe, as well as Padma Kahandawala, Violet Jayatilaka, as well as A.M. Jayatilaka, and Sumanapala and Indrani Dimatta Paksha. So, may the merit acquired today by this Dhamma talk be a blessing for all of them. May they all be well and happy and free from suffering. Moreover, whatever merit we acquired today by learning the Buddha's teachings, may we also share it with Anuradhi Chandrasekhara, as well as Jerry Chad, Damat Mahela Gunawardana Anup Avishka Gunawardana. So Anuradhi Chandrasekara is abroad, not in Sri Lanka, working and learning. She's gaining her education. So for all of them, may they rejoice in this merit, may they be well and happy, and free from suffering. Let's also share, finally, any merit we acquired today by this Dhamma talk with all of the victims of coronavirus throughout the world. May they all be well and happy, and make a speedy recovery from their illness. Sadhu, sadhu, sadhu. Namo Buddhaya, Teruvan Saranaya.